السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله، الحمد لله، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He has allowed me this opportunity to stand in front of you today and to participate in yet another important and critical event of our era. Because the fact of the matter, brothers and sisters, is that we are living at a very, very critical and important era of Islamic da'wah. We're living at a time and place when a lot of exciting things are happening, when the tide of Islamic activism is changing. We're seeing change, and all of it is positive. And this event is but one stepping stone. It's a major stepping stone, but it is but one of many stepping stones and many events that bodes well for the future of the Ummah in North America. Let me begin by a personal story, a story of my own legacy or my own ancestry here in North America. My father arrived on these lands almost 50 years ago, back in the early 60s. And he was one of the first of a wave of immigrants that continues to this day. And he arrived in this faraway land of Houston, Texas, from Karachi, from Pakistan, with hopes, aspirations, dreams, wanting nothing but an education so that he could go back home and return to his land. But as you all know, the typical story, he came here in 1963, and he was one of the first immigrant Muslims that arrived in Houston, Texas. And as the weeks turned into months and the months turned into years, and as he got married and he brought his wife here, and then as I was born, and then the tide began to change, he began to think of Islamic activism. It was not on his mind when he came here. When he came here, all he was thinking about was a master's and PhD. The last thing on his mind was to build masjids and to worry about Sunday schools. He had no experience in doing that, nor did he even have a vision for doing that. But as he had children here, he realized the need and the necessity, like so many other parents of his time and the times after him, that there was a responsibility. If he did nothing, then who else would do it? If he didn't protect the religion of his children, the identity of his children, then who else would stand up for the plate? And so he became one of the pioneers of formulating what is now the Islamic Society of Greater Houston. And he started Sunday school, which I remember attending as a very young child in the 70s. And slowly but surely, this center, ISGH, grew, and the Sunday schools also grew. And as more and more children were born, the Sunday school became a full-time school. And my father became more and more involved in Islamic da'wah. It wasn't his speciality. He didn't come trained in Islamic theology, Islamic fiqh, but there wasn't anybody else to step up to the podium. And I remember him telling me that when he first came in 1963, the Eid Salah that was held was composed of a total of three people. The Eid Salah in Houston, Texas, had three people, including the Imam. And they all got together, and they didn't really have an Imam. And so they told my father to lead the Eid Salah because they thought he would be the most qualified. And he had never led any Salah in his life, much less an Eid Salah. And so my father ended up giving the khutbah to a sum total of two people sitting in front of him. And that was the Eid Salah of 1963. Looking back at his generation, seeing the accomplishments that they have done, witnessing and experiencing all that is as we stand here today, I cannot help but state that I stand in complete and utter awe at their accomplishments. My father still has a picture of an Eid prayer in Houston, not from the 60s, but from the early 70s, before I was born. And it's one of those old Polaroid pictures. And I still have it. I look at it once in a while just to understand where we are. There are a total of 11 people, two of them are my parents. A total of 11 people, three African Americans, four Arabs, and the rest Indian Pakistanis. I think there's one Indonesian there as well. That was the sum total of Muslims in Houston, Texas. And I wonder if somehow miraculously we could transport ourselves back to that Polaroid photo, or even before, to 1963, when my father himself was not yet married. And I wonder if we could interview these people and we could ask them, what do you think would be the state of affairs 20, 30, 40, 50 years from now? What do you think will be the case for American Muslims in 2009? How do you think they will be? I don't think that in their wildest dreams, in their most concocted imaginations, they could possibly dream a vision of the reality that is today. I don't think that any of them could possibly imagine a world where their children are more practicing and more enthused about their spiritual and religious identity than they are of a supposed national identity back home. I don't think they could ever imagine the flourishing of conferences, ISNA and MANA and ICNA and MSA and all of these thousands and thousands of Muslims. I don't think they could ever imagine the large congregations, the packed masajids for Taraweeh. We have a lack of space in every single city in North America for Salatul Jum'ah and Salatul Taraweeh. We don't have enough masjids. While the other religious organizations are empty on their religious days, we have an overflowing, we have a parking problem, we have an overcrowding problem, we have a fire hazard problem, and alhamdulillah for all of that, I say. Alhamdulillah. It shows us that the spirit of Islam is well and alive. And I don't think that any person of that generation, in their wildest imaginations, could have possibly envisioned a world like the ones we live in today. And subhanAllah, I was humble last year when I was asked to give the Eid khutbah in the Houston National Convention Center, the largest convention center in Houston, Texas. And I was blessed to have my father attend there in front of me. And I said that 45 years ago, my father stood on the same symbolic podium that I am standing now. 45 years ago, it was my father delivering the khutbah. And there were only three people in that Eid khutbah of 1963. And here I am, now, today, standing in front of you. And there are not three, but rather there are 30,000 Muslims celebrating Eid in Houston, Texas. And my father is here witnessing this. What a miracle! What a miracle! How could anyone have possibly imagined that from 3 to 30,000 in the span of one living generation? One generation. And wallahi, I don't think that anywhere in the world, in our history, in the last 14 centuries, have we seen such a phenomenon. I don't think anywhere in our history have we had such a huge influx of immigrants and a huge group of converts that have come into the religion of Islam in such a short period of time and established themselves so rapidly. Yes, there are other stories, such as South Africa, such as areas of South America, but by and large it was one ethnicity and one time frame of immigration. The story of America, American Muslims, is a very American story. A multitude of ethnicities, people from all over the world coming, and in a very short period of time, relatively, 30, 40 years. And it is indeed a melting pot for American Muslims, as America is a melting pot for all of the nationalities and ethnicities and the religions of the world. Looking around us here today and witnessing the flourishing of Islam, I think that we should first and foremost be humbled in front of Allah. We should be grateful and thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And indeed, it is a promise of Allah that this religion will be protected regardless of what anybody else wants. But secondly, there should be another emotion as well. And that emotion is a bit of anxiety and worry that what will happen for the next generation. Alhamdulillah, we've gone this far, and the torch is indeed being passed. The torch is being passed, and that is overall a positive sign. And now I think is the perfect time that we pause for a while. We recollect our thoughts. We see where we've come from, and we also see where we plan to go. And I think this vision planning, I think many times we just get lost in the moment of what we're doing. And we stop thinking about the next step. We're only worried about right here and now. And we're not worried about tomorrow and the next year and 5 years and 10 years down the line. And so let me, in this short talk that I have, mention three areas that I'm very optimistic about for our generation. And three areas that I think we need to pay more attention to. Three areas that alhamdulillah, I think that this generation of Islam, a generation that is born and raised in this country, that feels comfortable being who we are, I think that inshallah we'll be able to take this torch and go a very, very far distance. The first of these three areas that I'm optimistic about, I firmly believe that the racial divides that my father witnessed and perhaps his generation to a certain extent participated in, because they imported those ideas from back home. I firmly believe that the ethnic differences and the racial divides that were prevalent in the 70s and 80s, we will, I'm not gonna say eradicate, maybe that's a little bit too much, but I think we will greatly minimize them, insha'Allah ta'ala. I am very confident that this generation will see a much more greater stress on unity, on unification. And we've already seen this with MANA. We've already seen this with ISNA and ICNA efforts. We've already seen this with the MSA. And even right here and now, we are all united for change. Despite our diverse backgrounds, ethnically, and any other differences that we have, we all have come together. And this is unprecedented in our short history in Islam in North America. And I'm very confident that this is just the beginning of a far more greater and a far more profound change. And it's not just the ethnic divides. Unfortunately, when our forefathers came in, they imported their imams and their local scholars, which was necessary for the time. Those local scholars imported a lot of the divisions from back home, and they exacerbated trivial matters that did not deserve the attention that unfortunately was placed upon it. In the end of the day, we are indeed all Muslims vis-a-vis those around us. We believe in the same God. We say the same prayer. We face the same Qibla. We recite the same book. We fast the same month. All other differences have a time and place and are much more trivial. In the end of the day, إِنَّ هَذِهِ أُمَّتُكُمْ أُمَّةً وَاحِدًا وَأَنَا رَبُّكُمْ فَاعْبُدُونَ. As Allah says, this is your ummah, it is but one ummah, and I am your Lord, so worship me alone. So this is the first of the three areas I feel very, very optimistic about. Sure, there are still minor divisions here and there left. There's still this notion of immigrant versus indigenous. Inshallah, we're working on it. And I think the frankness that we have and the honesty that we have, we're taking the bull by the horns. We're going to spot on, mention these differences and try to find a good and happy reconciliation. Inshallah ta'ala, this is the beginning of something very, very positive. The second of the three areas I'm optimistic about is our relationship with the broader American people. For our parents, America was always a host country. They were simply grateful for having been allowed the opportunity to live here. They were grateful for the rights. They were grateful for the economic privileges. They were grateful for the political freedom. But there was always this notion, and there still is this notion, of a place they call back home. I hear my parents talk, and they still speak about back home this happens, and back home that happens. And that's understandable. I would be the same if I were in their shoes. But that's the whole point. I'm not. I'm not in their shoes. I'm their son. And I was born and raised here. And I don't have a back home. When you say back home, I think of Texas. That's what I think of. I don't think of Karachi or Timbuktu or any other place. And I think that's a very positive overall sign. Unless and until we form an identity with the place we're living in, we're not gonna go very far. If we always think that we're here on a temporary visa, if we always think that these rights are gonna be revoked and we have to go back to some place, then obviously our productivity will be less. Our relationship with the other will always be minimized. And so alhamdulillah, it's a positive attitude that those of us of the second generation, those of us who have been born and raised here, we fully identify with the broader society around us, even if there are cultural differences, even if there are different ethics, different morals and moralities, of course it's understood. But overall, in the end of the day, we feel comfortable being who we are, and that is Muslim Americans. And the point is now, how does this come into play? When, for example, the Patriot Act was passed, many of the immigrant generation, my parents amongst them, they felt a sense of we have to now bow down under the pressure. It's expected. We lived a comfortable life for 20, 30 years. Now it's gonna get tough. We just have to be quiet and obey the law and do what we can. And I remember my father and I, we had a number of nice disputes about this. He didn't want me to be as active as I am. Why? Because he was scared that I would get into trouble. He was scared that the Patriot Act would come and take me away in the middle of the night and put me in Guantanamo. That's the way it's understood. That's how people of that generation thought, with all great respect to him. But that's how he grew up in his country. That's what they did back there. And I was telling my father, and I kept on telling him, this is not the way forward. If I stay at home, it's not going to help anybody. I need to go out. I need to be active. I need to speak up. If I don't stand up to defend my own rights, who else is going to do that? Because you see, for me, when Islamophobes, when right-wing people, when certain news agencies go and tell us to go back home, I don't have a concept of going back home. This is my home. And I can't stand, and I cannot just do nothing when my rights are stripped away one after the other. I have to fight legitimately, but I have to fight for my own survival and the survival of my children. This is a reality that only comes about when you have an identification with the land you're living in. I am an American, and I'm not going to allow my government to treat me the way they did. And when they did begin to intimidate and harass me, I went to the top authorities. I went to the Homeland Security. I went to the Muslim representative of the FBI. I went here. I went there. I went to my congressman. I went to my senator. I said, I will not be treated like a second-class citizen in this country of mine. And alhamdulillah, after many, many years of fighting on some unknown list they put me on, alhamdulillah, finally the name has been removed. You can't just sit back and do nothing. But the attitude to fight only comes when you have an identification with the broader land. And that is something, insha'Allah ta'ala, we of this generation do have. The third area that I'm optimistic about is actually a corollary of the second one. And that is our involvement in the political life and also by extension in the media. Alhamdulillah, we already have 2 Muslim congressmen. This is just the beginning of a lot more involvement. There are many, many Muslims working on the Hill. There's Ramadan iftars in the White House, in the Pentagon, in the Senate, in Congress. And many of the people who attend are Muslims who work in those offices. Many of the people who attend are in fact Muslims who work in those very areas. They're not just visiting dignitaries. And this is a positive sign, because when we become a part and parcel of the American fabric, that is when broader America will understand this is our land just as much as it is their land. No doubt a lot of work needs to be done. Nobody's denying that. But alhamdulillah, this is a positive change that we didn't see for the last 20 or 30 years. But along with these 3 points of optimism, there are also 3 other points. I'm not going to call them pessimism, because a Muslim is never pessimistic. A Muslim is always optimistic. The Prophet ﷺ said in hadith in Sahih Bukhari, "Al-fa'lu min al-iman." And he said, "Yu'jibuni al-fa'l." I like optimism. Optimism is a part of iman. The mu'min always looks at the bright side of life. The mu'min always sees the good things. This is a part of being iman, of having iman in Allah. حسن الظن بالله, having the best thoughts of Allah. So I'm not calling it areas of pessimism, but I am calling it areas we need to concentrate on more. Areas we should be a little bit worried about. Hurdles that we might have to face. The first of these hurdles, living as practicing religious Muslims in a secular state, balancing secular laws with the religious morality that the Sharia comes with. And this is not as pronounced of a problem in America as it is in many European countries. Especially in Europe, especially in France, a lot of our moralities, a lot of our ethics are slowly but surely being challenged. You cannot, as you know in France, wear the niqab in certain areas. You cannot preach certain doctrines except that there's going to be a lot of pressure. Doctrines that are mainstream Islam, ethics and morality, sexuality, what is and what isn't allowed. When you speak about the Islamic perspective, you are treated in extremely negative fashion. And we're going to have to balance gender issues, sexual mores and promiscuity, sexual orientation, the hedonistic lifestyle that has become prevalent in many parts of the Western world. We're going to have to balance this with our conservatism, with our ethics and morality of the Sharia. You all know when the Archbishop of Canterbury, last year was it, suggested that we have Islamic arbitration courts, a suggestion that was already occurring, by the way, and the Orthodox Jews already had something equivalent for the last 150 years. When he merely suggested that Muslims be allowed the same rights that the Orthodox Jews have, you all know what happened. Basically, the entire media calls for his resignation, calls for him stepping down from office, calls for him having gone mad and wild, and it became a national media circus simply for suggesting something that already is occurring in other religious communities. That's definitely a battle we're going to have to face. Another area of deep thought that we're going to have to worry about, and this is something that the right-wing Islamophobes always use, balancing our religious loyalties with our political loyalties. Are you with us or against us? Are you on our side or their side? And for a while, post 9/11, many of us fell for it. We didn't know how to answer. Many of us fell for the dichotomy of you're either with us or against us. It is a Machiavellian dichotomy. It's a dichotomy that is a part of, it's a fake dichotomy. You're either with America or against America. Who gets to define what is America? Herein lies the problem. Right-wing Islamophobes. I am an American, and I have just as much right to define what I think my foreign policy, the country, the foreign policy of my country should be doing as much as you have. And if it so happens that I disagree with you, well then there's always been disagreements. Every single group of Americans has always been battling for what they believe is right, what they believe is virtuous. Does anybody accuse Christians when they're opposed to sexual promiscuity, when they're opposed to abortion? Does anybody accuse Christians of trying to impose the Christian Sharia on America? They might not like it. Many left-wing liberals don't like it, but they don't accuse them of trying to impose Christian Sharia. They understand where they're coming from. Christians believe abortion is a crime against God. And if they're fighting legitimately to oppose abortion, if they're taking their cases to the court rather than taking it into their own hands, which is of course illegal, if they're doing petitions, if they're doing things legitimately, then we should have the exact same rights. We might have a different sense of morality than mainstream America, but that doesn't make us any less American. And I think here, one of the key things that we need to do, which is very strange in my opinion, but that's what I've been doing for the last few years, we need to re-educate Americans, the broader American population, about their own history. What is America? Why was it founded? Upon what values was this country founded upon? Why did those immigrants leave England and come here and found this common, they break away from the Commonwealth and found the Republic of America? What were those motivational factors? What visions and dreams did they have? We need to re-educate the broader American public that this is a country that was meant to include people of all races, all religions. It was not meant to be dominated by any one religion over another. And there are plenty of quotes from the founding fathers, by the way. And if we had time, we would go into that tangent. But there are plenty of quotes from the founding fathers, from Thomas Jefferson, from Washington himself, from Lincoln, from many of the people whom America admires as, and they have every right to admire them, as the founding legacies of this nation. There are plenty of quotes to show their vision of an America was a vision where every single religion could be as they are. And quite explicitly, they said, in one of the earliest declarations that they said, one of the earliest bills that was passed, they said, America is not in any sense of the term a Christian nation. This is something that they had with a treaty with Libya, with Tripoli. They explicitly said, we have no problems with Muslims, Mohammedans. We have no problems with the laws of any other religion because America is not a Christian entity. Thomas Jefferson signed this particular bill in Congress. He signed it. He had it passed. And it is available for everybody to view. How many Americans, especially the right-wing fundamentalists, are even aware that their own founding fathers said America is not a Christian land in any sense of the term? Literally, I quote you, it is not in any sense of the term a Christian nation. It's supposed to be a neutral nation. So I think the second problem here of balancing loyalties, it is a problem that in reality should be non-existent. It should be non-existent. Americans of all ethnicities and all creeds and all religions have their own loyalties. Irish Americans had a stance in the problems going on in Ireland. Jewish Americans have their loyalties. German Americans had their loyalties. Every single group of Americans, Christian Americans, have their loyalties. We have to be assertive enough. We have to be proud enough to defend what we believe to be truth and justice. I do not agree with foreign policy X. I do not agree with foreign policy Y. That doesn't make me any less of an American. Don't ask me to juggle between my loyalties. This is my loyalty. There's only one, and that is to truth and justice. So the second area, like I said, is this supposed conflict between our religious loyalty and our political loyalty. The response to this is to remind our broader Americans that There should never be a conflict between religion and politics. Every American citizen is entitled to his or her opinion, whether it's based upon religion or political affiliation, as long as it's done within the confines of the law. That's the second area. We're going to have to work a lot on that. If you listen to right-wing radio stations, if you listen to certain news agencies, you will understand a lot of Americans have no clue what America is all about. We're going to have to educate them. That's the second of the three. The third of the three fronts that I really think we're going to have to pay a lot more attention to, and alhamdulillah, attention is being paid to this, is the formulation of a new generation of indigenous scholars and leaders, imams and activists, people who are born and raised here, who speak fluent English in the vernacular of the people, and then they can recite Quran in the best accent and the most perfect tajweed. Those who can give a khutbah quoting our tradition and quoting Thomas Jefferson and Abraham Lincoln and every single philosopher that needs to be quoted. People who can combine the best of the East and the West. People who, when they stand up to give a khutbah, our high schoolers, our teenagers, instead of falling asleep, their ears perk up. Oh, mashallah, he's giving me the khutbah. I'm going to pay attention to this one. We need to form a new generation of Islamic activists. We need to stop outsourcing Islamic knowledge. And I'm not criticizing those who have come from abroad. I would not be who I am today were it not for the fact that I was trained and schooled by imams my father brought in and the people of his generation brought in. But that was 40 years ago. For how long are we going to outsource knowledge? For how long are we always going to go to other lands and other areas to bring our scholars? It's high time that we form local ulama. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran that وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا بِلِسَانِ قَوْمِهِ. We have not sent any messenger except that he spoke the language of his people fluently. وَإِلَىٰ عَادٍ أَخَاهُمْ هُدَىٰ وَإِلَىٰ ثَمُودَ أَخَاهُمْ صَالِحًا. To every group, their brother, their brethren, a part of their tribe. Allah says in the Quran, of his blessings, هُوَ الَّذِي بَعَثَ فِي الْأُمِّيِّينَ رَسُولًا مِّنْكُمْ. He has brought a messenger from amongst you. He's one of you. You know him. He speaks your language. He understands your customs and culture. This is the sunnah of Allah. It's high time we began implementing the sunnah. And alhamdulillah, there's a lot that's happening. So many institutes have formed. So many visions of universities and colleges are happening. And alhamdulillah, as I said, the tide is changing. But it is time we concentrate more on this and stop sending our kids overseas and start training them here so that they become more professional activists, better imams, greater scholars and educators, more relevant to the American scene. Of course, these are three issues, positive and not negative, but at least areas of concentration. And there are more than this. Overall, I am indeed very optimistic for the future of Islam in North America. And as I said, it is a turning point. The tides are changing. Alhamdulillah, we still have amongst us the living legends who formed the ISNAs and the MSAs and the great scholars who did what they did. Alhamdulillah, they're still amongst us. But slowly but surely, we see a new generation up and coming. We see other people coming to the forefront. And slowly but surely, the torch will be passed down. And it is a critical time now that we take account of where we were and where we're going. The way I look at it, it's as if we've reached a nice and comfortable hill, which allows us the opportunity to rest for a while, to look back and take advice from the scouts, from the guides, from the escorts who brought us to that hill. But then we realize that from now on, we're going to have to be moving on without the scholarship and the leadership of the mentors before us. So we take as much advice as we can and we scout the area in front of us to see the best course of action, to charter out the most productive and the fastest way for us to ensure the survival of our religion here in this lands. And my ultimate vision, my ultimate dream, as I look back to my own personal story and the story of my father here in America, and I see the struggles and sacrifices of my father and his generation, what he did to establish Islam, what he did to establish what we see around us, and I see myself involved in that struggle, an active part of it, and I see all of us sitting here today actively witnessing this positive change. My vision and my dua and my hope and my aspirations all lie in my children and their generation. My son is only 8 years old, but wallahi, I dream one day that him or somebody of his generation will stand on the same symbolic podium that his father and grandfather stood And that one day he will announce to an audience far larger than this one, far more magnificent and far more religious and enthused and practical and productive people of America, Muslims, proud to be who they are. I hope that one day he announces that just like his own father could never imagine how much Islam changed from his grandfather to his father's era. Just like in my wildest imaginations, I could not imagine what my son's generation will do. I hope that one day he stands before, or somebody of his generation stands before, and he says, we have witnessed yet another miracle. Even our fathers in their wildest dreams could never have imagined the flourishing of American Islam as we see today. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the iman, the tawfiq, the ikhlas. May he grant us the sincerity. May he grant us the knowledge. May he grant us the unity to achieve this goal. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us all ambassadors for his sake and his religion. May he make us keys that open up doors of good. And may he prevent us from being keys that open up doors of evil. Wa akhiru da'wana. An alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka al-abdi Muhammadin wa alihi wa sahbihi أجمعين. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.